I was pretty early. I was like October last year to jump on the Trump train. Michael, it turns out, he's been like, you know, as soon as he came out, he recognized that, that Trump was real, and he saw exactly what was the proper way for him to go. And so he was an early, not a convert, but he jumped on the Trump train real quickly. Just want to tell you a little bit about Michael, because what you see in Michael is kind of a reflection of what you see in Donald Trump. First of all, Michael, he's a CPA, so he knows business. He knows the business from the guts of the business. He understands how the money flows inside of a business and how things get paid for and receivables and payables and all that kind of stuff. He also understands taxes. He's got this kind of a mind. He is an entrepreneur. Michael had, 17, what was the name of the company?
Sport Clips Hair.
He had more franchises than anyone else in the entire country of these Sports Clips franchises. Michael did very well with that. Again, just the Trump model of persevering, doing a great job with a great idea, and then doing very well. Michael retired. He sold his businesses and retired. So then he's looking for a way to something to do the rest of his life. He decided to give back, just like Donald Trump has decided at this point to give back. So you can kind of see, I can see kind of psychologically why Michael would be drawn to Donald Trump, because they're thinking a lot of the same thoughts. And when he did this, Michael used his own money. He put his own money into his campaign, and he put in much more than he ever gets from his salary as a Georgia State Senator. They tried to destroy him. I was amazed, because Michael is he's in my district over in Forsyth County. I was amazed at the mailers that they were sending out there trying to destroy Michael and his family and everything that he holds dear in this life. Just like Donald Trump said, they will stop at nothing. Well, it goes through the entire system. The entire system is that way. But Michael's persevered. He would not be deterred. Well, what do you see Donald Trump doing? Donald Trump is not going to be deterred. He's going to take this all the way through. Well, in Michael's case, he was not going to stop. He was going to push this all the way through, and it just made him that much more of a tiger. And in the end, he defeated an entrenched state senator by a vote tally of 66% to 34%. And he did it out of sheer gutting it out and knocking on 20,000 doors and doing everything that he possibly had to do in order to complete the goal that he had set out for himself. And so with that in mind, I went to a Trump event this time last year, and I'm back there in the back, and I'm going in there, and I'm just going to see what's going on. There was no security there at that time. They were, you know, Trump was still the clown with the red nose on, so they didn't think anything of it. Well, I get in there, and there's Michael up in the front introducing Donald Trump. I'm like, holy crap. How's this guy doing this? I mean, it's like he's just like Superman. He just sets his goal on something and he's going to accomplish it. And so, the one thing I love about Michael more than anything is that he and I may not agree on everything, but you know what? He's a stand-up guy. And he'll tell you why he believes a certain way. And he won't be shy about it. And sometimes you can even persuade him. But sometimes he can persuade you. But he's not going to back down from anything. He doesn't take it personal. He's just, the guy has the heart of what we're looking for in this country to represent us in our seats of government. If you ask me, this guy is what governor material is made out of. And with that, I want to introduce you to my friend, state senator, and co-chair of the Trump campaign in Georgia, Michael Williams.
Thank you, Hank. I don't really know if I can live up to that that introduction there, but thank you. That was very kind of you. Also, I also want to echo his sentiments. Thank all of you for coming out tonight. We really are in a very, very important time in our country. The fate of our country is in our hands, in your guys' hands. The fact that you guys came out tonight means a lot about, to me, and a lot about where you guys stand. And also, what Hank did actually led up to exactly what I'm going to talk about. And I didn't tell Hank really what I was going to talk about, so it's kind of amazing. And one of them is, I'm going to tell you three different stories tonight. And at the end of the three stories, I'll kind of combine it, bring it all together. But the first one is why I got behind Donald Trump so early. And he's right, there's summer of last year, I came out and was the first elected official to support Donald Trump. And a lot of it is exactly what he talked about. I looked at Donald Trump. I looked at his background, and it resembled my background, but on a much smaller scale. I mean, I'm not worth billions of dollars. And I also looked at our country, and I looked at the 17 or so candidates that were running for the Republican nominee, and I saw a lot of good guys. I saw a lot of good guys that had a good heart, that wanted to do what they felt like was best for our country, and I felt like if they were elected, it would slow the process down a little bit. But none of them would be able to do what it would take to actually change the direction of our country. Only Donald Trump, in my mind, would be able to do that, would be able to withstand the attacks. And I want to go into a little more detail about some of the attacks that they did, because again, I was busy, before I got involved in politics, I was busy raising my family, running my own business, and I'd never really attended a Tea Party event, had never been to a GOP event, just spent time with my family and with my job. So whenever I first decided to run, I just started showing up some of these places, and people had no clue who I was. I sat down with my consultant, like, okay, we need to make a list of everybody you know in the county, so we can kind of get them start talking to everybody, get them start talking to friends. So they said, okay, who do you know? So I know about three people in the county. They're like, what do you mean, you know, three people in the county? That's all I know. I know I got my neighbors, I got my kids' teachers, you know, that's about all I know. So, well, how do you think you're gonna win this thing? I said, well, we're committed, we're gonna go out there, we're gonna work hard, and we believe that we can do it. One of the first things that I did was I called up Jack Murphy, the incumbent, and just let him know, hey, I'm Michael Williams, I'm gonna run for state senate, I'm gonna run for the office you hold. Do you want to meet? He said, sure. So he brought me over to his house. He sits me down and he starts to rattle off all these people that he knows, how close he is with the lieutenant governor, how you know, he's got the backing of every single person down in the Capitol. He's been in, down there for 12 years or so, and you know, he's really, really entrenched. And if Michael, if you just hold off a little bit, if you just hold off, you know, get involved more in the community, we can put you on a board here, we can get you there, basically earn your stripes, let us know we can trust, let you know that you're gonna do the things you're supposed to do, then maybe in the coming years, you know, you can run for office. Basically telling me, if we can indoctrinate you first of all and put you in place, then maybe you can run. I said, well, Jack, I appreciate that, but I feel very convicted that I need to run for this office. Whether win or lose, I'm gonna run, and I appreciate that. I said, well, you know what? At the snap of a finger, I can call Casey Cagle up and get $250,000 to run for my campaign. I said, dang it, Jack, I was hoping you wouldn't say that, because I got this consultant who said it's going to cost me about $300,000 to run this campaign. I was just hoping he was just saying that. So if that's what it's going to take, that's what it's going to take. And I ended up actually spending about $330,000 of my own dollars in this campaign. The next thing I had was with Mark Hamilton. He was kind of Jack's counterpart there in Forsyth County. He brings me into his office. We're sitting there, we're talking. A lot of the same stuff. You know, why don't you just get more involved in the community? You know, why do you want to do this? Blah, blah, blah. In the middle of it, I think it was orchestrated. I don't have anything to prove this, but I think it was orchestrated. He gets his phone rings. He looks down and he says, hold on a minute. It's the Speaker of the House. He asked me to leave his office. So I leave his office about 5 minutes. Then comes back in and says, I thought that was the Speaker. We had to talk about a couple of things, whatever. So I think that was his way to try to intimidate. But again, I'm not really involved in politics. I don't know who the Speaker of the House is, so it didn't really matter to me who was calling. So we ran the race, and we announced. About a month after we announced, I get this unmarked vanilla envelope full of all kinds of horrific things. They had gotten in touch with my ex-wife. And she had basically accused me of everything under the sun, with the exception of being a pedophile. There are accusations about me having gambling problems, problems with prostitutes, strippers, you name it. I had done it. I beat my wife. I neglected my kids. It was all kinds of horrific stuff. And then there was this typed out note that said, if you do not withdraw from the race, this will be made public. Well, I held on to that. I didn't let anybody know about it whenever it first came out. Jack, the brilliant guy that he is, once session starts in January, he starts going around. Because what they do down there is they talk about the guys that are running against you. And they all talk about how crazy they are, how nut jobs they are, whatever it is. And he had these papers. And he was going around showing everybody, you know, look, this guy's crazy, this guy's nuts, this guy's a wife beater, this guy's, you know, whoever it might be. Well, about a month in the session, we make this announcement that we had received this envelope, had all this horrible stuff in it. Well, Jack can't deny it anymore because he's been going around telling everybody about it. So he's kind of caught red-handed that he was the one that did it. But they sent out mailers. They created this website called Michael Williams Gone Wild. And they sent out mailers, everybody directing them to this website. And it was so bad that they took my mom's name, birth date, address, and social security number, and put it on the internet. That's how bad it was. And like Hank talked about, we didn't let that deter us. I had all kinds of people call saying, Mike, you gotta do this, Mike, you need to do this. And I was just kind of retaliating to some of the stuff. And I was like, no, we have our message, we have what we wanna do, and we're not going to be distracted from that. We're just going to focus on what we feel like is important, and that is fairly being represented. Because when you really think about that, that's what we all want, and none of us feel like we have, is fair representation, either at the state level or at the national level. And we went, we knocked on $20,000, spent $330,000. We spent, my kids, they're in spring break, while all their other friends are at the beach enjoying themselves, we're out there knocking on doors and working our tails off. And sure enough, we won. Went 66 to 34. And I would love to say that it was all because of me, because I am just such a great, amazing guy. But I know that's not true. I know we worked their tails off. I know that I was given resources that I was able to put into the campaign. But I also know we prayed every single night. That we turned our hearts to our Father in heaven, and I felt like He wanted me to run. And those that might have heard last time I spoke, I talked about that a little bit, and I felt convicted that I needed to run. And everybody I talk to is, I need to run, I'm going to do everything I can because I feel like I need to run. Never did I say I need to win. I just needed to run. If I did everything that I could do, put it in God's hands, He would take care of the rest, and He did, and we won. That's kind of the first story. The second story is, I was boarding an airplane here in Atlanta, going to Richmond, Virginia for a conference this past summer. And one of the things I like to do to combat some of what the media says out there is I love wearing Donald Trump paraphernalia. I have a Donald Trump shirt, I've got a Make America Great hat, and I put on my Make America Great hat, went down to Hartsfield International Airport, and wore that hat all over the place. And I got some high fives, some handshakes, and I got some kind of scary looks as well. So, you know, how dare you wear that hat at this airport or whatnot. And I was going through security. You know, the guy that's standing right there, you have to give your boarding pass and your license. They let you go through to get screened and all that. He was a black guy. I give him my stuff, got on my Make America Great hat, and he lets me go by. And as I'm walking by, he said, "Excuse me, sir." And I turn around. I'm kind of preparing myself for what's he going to say? How am I going to respond to this? I turn around and I say, "Yes, sir." He's like, "We really need to get that guy elected." I was like, "Yes, I love it." So I went through security, went, boarded the plane. Now, as I was boarding the plane, I got one of those kind of stink eye looks from one of the stewards. And I just kind of smiled at her, went down and sat in my seat. About the time the plane is supposed to take off, we hear an announcement over the intercom saying that the flight has been delayed. They're waiting on the co-pilot. It's going to take a little bit longer, but we've got to figure out where he is, how long it's going to take, so he's just going to bear with us. We hear that story a few more times. The flight is delayed by about 20 minutes. Again, I'm just kind of sitting there in my chair, annoyed that the flight's delayed, but not really doing anything. When we land, I was traveling with David Schaefer, Senate President Pro Tem. He was sitting in first class and kind of witnessed what was going on that really caused the delay. The stewardess, I only assume it was the stewardess that gave me that stink eye, made a stink about my hat, and she called it a microaggressive act. All right, again, remember, my hat said, "Make America Great Again." And on the back, it had Trump. That was it. But she felt like that was a microaggressive act. So they were talking this entire time. The stewards were talking, okay, what are we going to do? How are we going to handle this? Should we kick him off the plane? Should we make him take his hat off? How are we going to handle this? And they take a vote. There's three of them. It was 2-1. Not to do anything. The stewardess wasn't very happy about that. So she went to the pilot. Had the same discussion with the pilot. Now, this is a microaggressive act. He's offended me. We've got to do something about it. Thank goodness the pilot made the right decision and didn't do anything as well. But nonetheless, we were delayed 20 minutes because of this. The reason I share that story is, again, the media. Why did that stewardess feel like my hat was a microaggressive act? Why did she take offense to that hat? If you take it for what it's written very literally, it's we're going to just make America great. But the media has ingrained upon people that that represents Donald Trump, who is a racist, a sexist, a xenophobe, all these horrible and horrific things. Well, why is the media driving this narrative home so hard? In my mind, it's because Hillary Clinton is by far the worst candidate the Democrats have had in my lifetime, if not ever. They know that they have a very limited number of people who are going to come out and vote for Hillary Clinton. The only way for her to win is to suppress the vote, to make people question, why would I, well, not even want to be associated with Donald Trump. I don't want to be classified with him. I can't tell you how many people, I've been traveling the state, stumping for Trump, talking to people about Donald Trump, and how many people, when you first talk to them about the presidential race, they're kind of hesitant, you know, I don't really like either candidate, blah, blah, blah. When they find out that I'm the state co-chair of the Donald Trump campaign, the first elected official in Georgia to endorse Donald Trump, their tune changes. Oh, I really do like Donald Trump. You know, I think he can do some good things. I think he can do some great things. And but they had to get permission from me, first of all, before they felt comfortable enough to say that. Again, that's just because of what the media is doing. I was playing basketball with a guy the other day who I go to church with, and he just hates Donald Trump. And I'm like, well, why? Why do you hate him so bad? Just his policies, blah, blah, blah. So I start rattling off, you know, his tax policy. As we're playing basketball, we're playing down low, we're kind of bumping each other and following each other and all that. We're talking politics at the same time, talking about the difference between Donald Trump's tax policy and Hillary Clinton's tax policy, abortion, all these different things. And about an hour into the game, he just kind of reluctantly leans over and says, all right, I'm probably going to vote for Donald Trump, but don't tell anybody. Again, just... They're out there pushing this narrative because they know that Hillary Clinton has a cap, and they have to prevent people, not legally, but you know, by stereotyping, by making it so you don't want to associate with them. You don't want to stand up for them either. We gave a neighbor a Donald Trump sign. Actually, it was kind of a joke. We made a bet with them. They lost the bet. And I said, I'm going to put a Donald Trump sign in your yard because you lost the bet. And middle of the night, I go out there, I put it in their yard. And they wake up the next morning and they see a couple people drive by. And in their minds, the people that drove by gave them the stink eye. And they thought it was because it was a Donald Trump sign. Again, just the ingrainedness of what the media has done. So that's part of one of the reasons why I wanted to support Trump was some of these other guys that were running, there's no way that they could stand up to the pressures that the media is going to put against them. Only somebody that is as arrogant, as egotistical as Donald Trump could actually go through and do this. The last story that I want to kind of tell you is more of a personal story to me that I might go teary-eyed, so please apologize or send my apology beforehand. But on July 23rd of last year, my son was involved in an accident. It was a longboarding accident. I've got three kids, two sons and a little girl, and they were out playing with their longboard. He wasn't wearing a helmet. He fell, he hit his head, and he had to go to the hospital. I wasn't with him at the time. I got a call from his other brother, Jared. He said, "Dad, Emma had an accident here. Talk to the police officer, tell you what happened." The police officer said, "You know, his son, he hit his head, ambulance came, took him to the hospital just as a precautionary issue, and he should be okay." So as I was driving to the hospital, I was more mad at my son than anything else, because this isn't really new to him. He's very accident prone. He takes some risks he probably shouldn't take. And I was thinking, okay, I'm going to take his car away. I'm going to do all these different things to punish him. But when I get to the hospital, I realized pretty quickly, this isn't our typical emergency room visit. He was in a room all by himself. It wasn't in one of the rooms where there's lots of other people, just partitioned by a little screen or whatnot. He had his own little room. He was sitting in the middle of it, and the cords were coming down from the ceiling. He was hooked up to all these machines over to the right, and he was no longer responsive. When the police officer told me, first of all, he was responsive. He was no longer responsive at this point. We were in there for about 10 minutes, and the nurse came in and rushed us out. And they said, "We have to intubate your son." And I remember walking out of his little room there thinking, okay, this is not good. This is going to be a very, very rough night for us. This was about 4 or 5 o'clock in the afternoon. They intubated him, put him in a room, put him in an IC room. We're in there, we're with him again. He's still out. He's not responsive. Nurses are coming in, checking on him at about midnight. The nurses run in, mess with him, and then rush him out and say, "We have to do emergency surgery. His brain has expanded so much that it's putting pressure on his spinal cord, and if we don't basically remove his skull, he's going to die." So obviously that was some horrific news that we had to hear. The surgery was supposed to last about an hour and a half. It was about 2.5 hours later. He finally comes back. He's alive, but the doctor brings us to the back and pretty much tells us, "You know, your son's alive, but we've done everything that we can do for him. Whether or not he continues to live or not will be up to him. But if he does live, he's not going to be the same son that you remember. His brain has expanded so much, and on top of that, he had had a stroke where he lost about 15% of his right frontal lobe. So again, if he makes it, we just want you to be prepared that there's going to be some challenges. He's going to have to learn to walk, learn to talk. He's going to have to learn to read and write. He's going to have to learn all these things all over again. And it's going to be a very, very challenging life for him." Well, the next 4 or 5 days, probably the worst days of my life. We had to watch my son go through what's called neuroshock, where his body basically just shuts down, and every ounce of energy that he has is going to heal his brain. His body can no longer control his temperature, regulate his temperature, so his temperature will spike up to 104, 105, 106 degrees. They'll put ice on him and all that, and then it'll drop to 92, 93, 94 degrees. And it was always worse at night. You know, I remember one day just kind of sitting with my wife thinking, "Oh, goodness, watching the sunset. Here we go again." After about 4 or 5 days, though, they were able to wake him up. He was in an induced coma. They were able to wake him up, and a week after that, we were able to transfer him out of ICU into the Shepherd Center. And for anybody who doesn't know, the Shepherd Center is a world class, really, which is one of the best organizations and hospitals in the world when it comes to brain and spinal injuries. So we're able to get him into Shepherd's, and they bring him in. And they tell us the same things, like, "You know, I know you love your son, I know you're going to be there for him, but we just want to prepare you that this is going to be a very, very long process. It could take up to 2 years for us to really know the full impact of what's going to happen." They sat us down and brought in nurses and other people to kind of get the lay of our home, how we're going to have to handicap it and do all these things. During all this, our story had gotten out there. A lot of you, I've kind of seen say shaking their heads, and yeah, I remember the story. We had people around the state, around the country. In fact, we've counted 7 different countries around the world where people were praying for my son. And what happened is nothing short of a miracle. And that is two weeks after we were accepted in the Shepherds, my son walked out of the hospital able to read and write and remember. This happened in July. He missed the first half of school. He says he was a senior. He missed the first half of school. He was able to go back to school in January and graduate with his class. It is nothing short of a miracle. I told you earlier that I won the election, but not because of me, because of my Father in Heaven. And when I won, I didn't really know why the heck I won. I mean, I don't know what I'm doing down there. I try to figure it out. I'm pretty quick learning, quick study. So I think I've kind of picked up a lot of what's going on. But what I've done is everywhere I go to speak, I share that story. Because no matter what happens to me going forward, if I can share the story that God lives, that God loves us, and He still performs miracles, I feel like I've done my job. Now, the reason I share that with you is because I truly believe in miracles. And I believe that Donald Trump is a miracle that the American public needs.
Amen.
He might not be the miracle that we want, you know. He might not be, you know, if we could say this is the guy that we want to represent us, he's probably not that guy. But again, he has gone through some stuff. He has the personality and the attributes that we need right now as Americans. Like him, love him, hate him, he's the guy that's going to help change our country. Now, he is up against, I mean, we heard it from his own mouth, he is up against a machine that is going to do everything that they can to destroy him. And that's where the miracle part comes in for me. Not necessarily that's Donald Trump, but that to overcome that machine, to overcome everything that they're going to do to try to give the election to Hillary, it's going to take God's effort. And we as citizens, we as Americans, we as Christians, we need to do everything we can to lift them up in our prayers. We need to do everything that we can to ask God to help us elect the right person. Because I don't think we can do it ourselves. I think we're to the point now where it's going to take God's hand coming down and helping us to win this election. So that's what I ask everybody to do. There's two things I ask people to do. One, pray to lift up Donald Trump in your prayers. And then do not be ashamed or scared or intimidated in showing your support for Donald Trump. Because if you do, you're allowing the media to win. You're allowing them to win. And we cannot do that. We have to take it upon ourselves to lead the charge, to lead this movement, to lead this revolution. And it starts with every one of us. Good question.
Well, I took your lead and I actually did it. I put a Trump bumper sticker on the back of my car. So you can imagine going down 316, 85 to 285 every morning and having people do this. And almost swerve over because they actually cannot believe that I have that on the back of my car. But now I'm getting waves and humps, and I'm like, am I the only one riding around with this on their car? Like, yes, I am.
Yeah, no, I mean, just to see a black individual with a Trump bumper sticker, want to see a Trump bumper sticker, and then to go up the Trump in front of the car and see, wow, it's a black person, completely defies what's being pushed down everybody's by server now by the media. So congratulations and keep it up. So that's kind of the story about how I got behind Donald Trump. That's why I think Donald Trump is the guy. Again, he's not perfect. Not by any stretch of the imagination. He has said some things that I find offensive. The comments that he made with the Bush character, horrific. I mean, if I was president and I heard him talk about that, I would be completely offended by it. But doesn't mean that he's not fit to be president. It doesn't mean that he can't make the right decisions, right choices. And he's doing it by calling out all the corruption. Can you see Ted Cruz? Can you see Jeb Bush doing any of this? Not at all. Not at all. He's the guy that's leading the charge, and he's the guy that we need to support.
Talking about miracles, I see the fact that Trump is where he is as a miracle. We had 17 candidates, and the clown, as they called him, rose to the top doing everything that was politically wrong. If that's not a miracle, what is?
No, exactly, exactly. And also, whenever we hear these polls, anybody here believe the polls?
No.
Good.
Ask if anybody ever been polled.
Has anybody ever been polled?
Yeah, I actually was polled. Yeah. I was polled.
Okay, so we got two. We got two.
Does anybody, everybody else, do you know anybody that's ever been polled besides this lady here?
Who's
watching?
Me. Yeah, and then Jim in the back. Thank you. During the primary, we all heard the pollsters out there talking. You know, he comes up pretty strong. I think it was 17-18%. They said he might cap out at 22%, and as all the other candidates start to fall off, they're not going to Trump. Trump's maxed out. Trump's got everybody that he's going to get. As these candidates start to fall off, they're going to go to everybody other than Trump. And who kept getting a disproportional part of the votes? Donald Trump. Every single time, more people went to him than any other candidate. And you're absolutely right. That just the fact that he is where he is a modern-day miracle. And I don't trust the polls out there today. Again, I was at an Atlanta Young Republicans gathering. It was February of last year. So there were still quite a few candidates in the running for the GOP. And I was down there and I said, I know you guys kind of laugh at me and whatnot because I support Donald Trump, but I'm going to tell you something else that you're really going to laugh at. I mean, this was February before he'd won the nomination. Not only is he going to win the nomination, he's going to be the GOP nominee, but he is going to win the general election by a landslide. It is going to be huge. And I believe whatever we see on November 9th, we're in November 9th, is only going to be a fraction of what it really is. Because he is going to win this thing huge. I can't tell you how many people, again, as they're going around there. And not just Georgia. You know, you're a Georgia State Senator. Obviously, Georgia's going to go red. But as I've traveled all over the state, as I talk to people all over the state, I was talking to a guy in California the other day, and he was driving down the road. He said whenever he got there, he was expecting to see Hillary stuff everywhere. So he saw like two bumper stickers and maybe a one-yard sign. Nobody is excited about Hillary Clinton. Even her own party isn't excited about Hillary Clinton. But yet, look at early voting.
Well, they have to bus people in for rallies.
Yeah, how many people show up for our rallies? 200-300, you know, and we've got 10,000 and 12,000 people showing up for Donald Trump rallies. But here in Georgia, early voting, we've had over 100,000 people early vote. That was just the first day. I haven't seen after 4 days, but in Forsyth County, 8% of registered voters have already early voted. I'm telling you, it's not for Hillary Clinton. People, and nationwide, again, on the first day of early voting, over 1.1 million people early voted. Every single state doesn't have early voting 3 weeks out. People are excited about what Donald Trump represents and the change that he can bring to our political system. And with that, I'll take any questions.
I have one comment. I think WikiLeaks has been our NSA to get the facts out. Mm-hmm. Stuff's coming out every day.
Exactly.
And they cut him off in Paris, but you know, he's got alternate systems. You know, it's like blood flow. They got to come through another way.
Yeah. And did you guys see how Hillary Clinton pivoted on that question at the debate? You know, she never wants to deny that she said it because she can't deny. I mean, it's evidence that she said it. So she, instead of admitting it and saying, yes, I do believe in open borders, even though I've said earlier tonight that I don't, it's Russia's fault. You know, it's Russia's fault that I can't, you know, play you guys, and because Russia's doing it. And oh yeah, by the way, Donald Trump is associated with Russia. So again, it's just a humongous curve they're trying to throw to convince the American people that WikiLeaks is a traitor. Don't believe it. Only believe Hillary Clinton because she is going to tell you what you want to hear.
Questions?
Any other questions?
What committees are you on?
I am on the Ethics Committee. I'm the Vice Chair of Ethics. I serve on the Finance Committee, Higher Education Committee, Public Safety, and State and Local Governments. But that will change in January. We have a new biennial. We have a few more senators coming in and changing in committee assignments. So hopefully I'll get a couple different ones.
I have a question.
Somebody had asked, I don't know if they still want an answer, but I do. Can you explain your support for Amendment 1, if in fact?
I think that's the question you're going to ask as well, what I think about Amendment 1. I voted yes on the bill for Amendment 1. A lot of that was for straight up political reasons. There are other bills I had going through that one of them was before this bill that I was working on passed, it was an ethics violation for a member of the school board to vocally oppose an issue once it was voted on. That was the state school board's position, that once a measure is voted, you have to fall in line, you cannot speak out against it. I think that's wrong, it's completely wrong. So I presented a bill that said that the state board cannot have anything that prevents a board member from exercising their First Amendment right to speak up no matter what happens. I knew that if I voted against Amendment 1, the Constitution Amendment, that bill would die. So in my mind, it was more important to get that out there so we could have board members across the state. We talk about local control. We can't have local control if our board members can't speak up. We need our board members at the local level to have their voice and let people know what's going on.
Butch Miller was talking about that moment. Wasn't Butch Miller the one toting that particular bill?
The bill I'm talking about right now?
Yeah.
No, that was the bill I sponsored.
No, I meant the other.
Oh, Amendment 1?
You voted on 1. On this one.
Yeah, Butch was the lead sponsor of Amendment 1.
So just to make sure I understand you, you voted for this so that another bill you were putting forth would not die.
That's part of it. The other one is, yes, that's partly correct. The other reason is whenever it comes to constitutional amendments, and you know, I represent the people that elected me, but I also like for them to have their voice as well. And a constitutional amendment is able to go to the people so that they can vote on it as well. So for those two reasons, I voted for it. But I've also said that, in fact, I was on a radio station in Athens just last week where I said that I would be voting no on the ballot question.
Just my opinion.
Sure.
Based on what was presented today, basically the people who have this, most of those failing schools are in poor black areas where they won't even go and participate. And according to this legislation, once the governor's choice makes up his mind, there is no appeal. So I don't see the upside of voting yes for this to give the people the voice when they won't have one anyway if this passes. And
what if that doesn't pass? There's a lot of opposition out there.
Well, what was made?
There's a ton. You know that there's only been one school system in the entire state that's come out in support of this? Other school system has come out against this amendment.
I've not seen any opposition to it.
I have.
I've missed that, and I hope that.
And again, I don't know if it's going to pass or not. I don't have any inside polling or anything like that. But also another thing that I do like about what's going on right now is we're actually talking about education and solutions. And we do have a poor education system in Georgia that needs help, and this is bringing this to the forefront where we can talk about it and hopefully come up with some solutions that will work. If this does pass.
If you're interested, the current polling is 44% against, but unless that hits 50, it won't matter. So,
what is for it?
34. It's about 44, 34, and then 20.
So 44 is against?
44 is against,
yeah. And 34 is for it?
Yes. And 20% is undecided. That's the only current polling that we have on.
Okay. Well, everybody get on social media and every platform that you possibly have and let your opinion be known. Got one more question.
Kind of going off of education, sure. So young people, right? Well, why is there such lack of young people entering in both the Democrat and Republican parties right now? Y'all are getting older and older, and they're just kind of checked out.
Well, are you a part of a party right now? Are you?
I am a part of a group. Yes.
The Republican Party. The Democrat Party?
I am a member of the alt-right.
The what?
The alternative right.
The alternative right. Okay. Okay.
I was formerly a member of the Republican Party, but
you left it.
Well, with what they've done to Trump, I can't, with good conscience. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Let's first of all, I can only speculate as to why some of the younger people are not being a part of the party, or either party. So I don't have any factual or anything I can kind of point to other than just my own intuition. But I would have to speculate that they just don't feel like either party represents them. When you look at what is portrayed out there by the media, you have the Democrats who are very socially liberal, and that's what their push is. When you look at what's being pushed down by the media, what Republicans are, they're these right-winged Christians that want to Bible beat everybody with a head. So as a young person, which one of those appeals to you?
Neither.
And so I think that's why that both parties, particularly the Republican Party, needs to do a better job of messaging about what we are really about. And that's also one of the reasons why I like Donald Trump so much. I've had people ask me, well, Michael, isn't the fact that all these Republicans are turning on Donald Trump, don't you see that as a bad thing? I say absolutely not. I think that is a very good thing because he's weeding out those who really don't believe in Republican principles. And when he wins, and when he gets down to D.C., do you think it's going to get any easier? No, it's not getting any easier. He needs to know who's going to be there, who's going to have his back, who's going to be with him through thick and thin, and that's what he's figuring out right now, is who's going to stay with him. So I hope that kind of answers your question. And then lastly, before I turn it over, I do want to kind of stand up for the governor. I got to know the governor, and while you might not necessarily approve of OSD and then the school district, I do believe that both the governor and Sandra Deal are doing this from a good place to be. What I have seen down there is all kinds of information is thrown at you, all kinds, some good, some bad, and it's really hard sometimes to sift through what is right and what is wrong. But I really do believe that the governor and the first lady are trying to do this from a good place in their heart.
So the attempt to legalize no-knock search warrants, which is codified already as being illegal, is from a good place in his heart.
Okay, so what does no-knock search warrants have to do with the OSD?
That's another story, and I know okay. Hank is ready to close out.
So, on Opportunity School District, I've been really disappointed with the governor, but then I'm hearing from people down at the Capitol that he's really been misled by very young staffers. What's going on? Why would he be so fooled? You've been truthful the whole night, so just say the truth. No one here will tell.
Yeah. I'm going to answer that by saying I'm going to pull a political stunt here. I can't answer that directly.
Your face answer.
I can't answer that directly. But what I can say is that this past session there was a lot of bills that were passed that helped teachers as far as testing. That we reduced the number of testing. There's going to be some more bills coming out from the governor that will not just affect the Opportunity School District, but all the schools to help with the funding, to help again with more testing, to help everybody else in education. So again, I believe he really wants to do a good job. And
you need to agree with the guy.
He also vetoed the gun bill and religious liberty, so yeah. He's not perfect.
Well, thank Michael. Everybody give him a hand.